وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Today we'll do درس الخامس, which is lesson number 5 from the book of Tadribat for Mustawa al-Awwal, meaning level 1. However, before we start lesson 5, Dars al-Khamis, I want to just spend about 5 minutes revising what we did earlier in Dars al-Rabi. Dars al-Rabi, lesson 4, it had a few new principles adding on to what we had done earlier, the first of which was the Harf al-Jar. And Harf al-Jar, examples of the Harf al-Jar that we did last time, there were 4. One was Fi, and Fi means in. Another was Ala, and Ala is on. And Ila, which is to. And Min, which is from. And if you recall from last time, these Harf al-Jar or Huruf al-Jar, the plural, they come before a noun. And noun, mind you, in Arabic is called al-ism. So the harf al-jar come before a ism or a noun, and the effect of harf al-jar on the ism after it is to make the ism end with a kasra. Without the harf al-jar, the ism by default would end with a dhamma, but with the harf al-jar it will end with a kasra. So the example for that would be al-baytu, meaning the house, al-baytu, the house. Once we put harf al-jar fi, it becomes al-baytu, becomes fil-bayti, meaning inside the house. Likewise, al-maktabu becomes ala al-maktabi, ala al-maktabi, meaning on the table. So putting those two in a sentence, you would say Muhammadun fil-bayti, or al-rajulu fil-bayti. And likewise, we'd say al-qalamu ala al-maktabi, al-daftaru ala al-maktabi, or al-haqibatu ala al-maktabi, and so on. Another thing we did last time was asking a question and then replying to the asking a question with ayna, ayna meaning where, and replying to it instead of by the name of the person, replying to where by using a pronoun. The pronoun for the male was huwa, meaning he or it, and pronoun for the female is hiya, meaning she or it, a feminine thing. And the examples of that, ayna Muhammadun, huwa fil ghurfati, ayna al-kitabu, huwa ala al-maktabi. That were two examples of male. Now, two more examples of female, one a human being, the other an object. أين آمنة هي في المطبخ. أين الساعة هي على السرير. So replying with a pronoun, هو or هي, for male and female respectively. That was another thing we did last time. The third of the main principles done last time was the use of تنوين. تنوين, remember, is to repeat. Tanwin is to double the sign at the end of the word. So a word may end as bay al-baytu, al-baytu, and it has only one dhamma, the u sound at the end. Tanwin is when you have two dhamma, and that would be if there was no al in the beginning of the word. So you would say baytun. So baytun is one with a tanwin. And what we had done last time in Ad-Dars al-Rabi' in lesson 4 was the name of a male person ends with a tanween, whereas the name of a female person does not end with a tanween. So the examples of that for the male people was Muhammadun, Hamidun, Khalidun, Abbasun, Aliyun, and so on. So they all finish with un, which is the tanween with dhamma. As for the female person, there was no tanween in it. And examples of that are Aminatu, Khadijatu, Fatimatu, Aishatu, Zainabu, Maryamu, and so on. So notice it's not Maryamun, but it's Maryamu. And it's not Khadijatun, but the correct is Khadijatu. So there's no tanween in the name of a female person. The fourth of the principles we did in Dars al-Rabi' was asking someone from where they are. From is min, where is aina, and you is anta. So it's ask min aina anta. Min aina anta, from where are you? And the jawab, the answer to that question would be ana, meaning I, min as in from, asini. Asin meaning China. So the example answer for that would be ana min asini. Ana min asini. Another alternative answer, min aina anta? Al-jawab, ana min al-hindi. Ana min al-hindi. Another alternate answer, min aina anta? And the jawab, ana min Malaysia. Or ana min Indonesia. And likewise, min aina anta, you would reply also, you could say ana min America. These type of names, Malaysia, Indonesia, America, they finish with a a sound at the end. And therefore, even though you put a harful jar min before it, you can't turn the America or Malaysia, that sound of a at the end, you can't turn it into a e sound. Therefore, it stays as Malaysia and min Indonesia and so on. The fifth of the main rules we did last time was to introduce the usage of the verb. Verb in Arabic, of course, is called fa'l. Remember, ism was called, sorry, the noun is called al-ism, whereas a verb is called a fa'l. So we did a past tense verb last time. Ayna talibu, where is the student? Ayna talibu. The jawab, the answer, kharaja. Kharaja means he went out. You could add on and say kharaja min al-bayti. He went out of the from the house. Or you could say kharaja min al-fasli. He went out from the classroom. Then you further ask, he has gone out of the house or the classroom, but where did he go to? So the verb for going away or going to somewhere, it's dhahaba. Dhahaba, and going to is ila. So you would say dhahaba ila. So the su'al would be أَيْنَ الطَّالِبُ خَرَجَ وَأَيْنَ ذَهَبَ, where did he go? وَأَيْنَ ذَهَبَ, and the jawab would be ذَهَبَ إِلَى الْمِرْحَاضِ. ذَهَبَ إِلَى الْمِرْحَاضِ. Or if you want to mention who did that action, then you mention the name of the person who did the action right after the fi'l, right after the verb, and you would put on the doer of the action, you would make that word end with a dhamma. So instead of saying ذَهَبَ إِلَى الْمِرْحَاضِ, you want to add who is the one who went to the toilet, which is here of course the طالب, the student. So you would say ذَهَبَ الطَّالِبُ إِلَى الْمِرْحَاضِ. ذَهَبَ الطَّالِبُ إِلَى الْمِرْحَاضِ. So ذَهَبَ is فِعْل, or الفعل الماضي, meaning it's the past tense verb. And الطالب is called in Arabic الفاعل. الفاعل is the doer of the action. And الفاعل ends with a dhamma. And that's why we said ذهب الطالب إلى المرحاض. This is the summary of the things we had done in الدرس الرابع in lesson number 4. Then moving on to الدرس الخامس. الدرس الخامس has a few new principles as well. However, these also just add on a few more points to what we've done so far, such that it's not too much of the new stuff coming through. The first of the principles in Ad-Dars al-Khamis, in lesson number 5, it's a very important principle to grasp because it's used so frequently in Arabic language. Even in English, its equivalent is used so frequently as well. But especially in Arabic, it's so common to use this. This principle is called mudaf and mudaf ilayh. Mudaf means an addition, and mudaf ilayh is the thing that the addition is done to. So mudaf and mudaf ilayh is a unit of two words, and we connect these two words to each other in a certain way. The equivalent of this in English would be to say the teacher's pen, meaning the pen of the teacher. So what do we do to say the pen of the teacher? We say the teacher's pen. So after mentioning the teacher, what do we do in order to connect the two words, the pen of the teacher? We add an apostrophe and a s after teacher. So we said we write down teacher apostrophe s, pen, teacher's pen. Likewise in Arabic, we would be either deleting or adding something to each of the two words to connect the two together. So now the example would be the teacher's pen. Pen in Arabic is qalamun. Pen in Arabic is qalamun. And qalamun is a pen. And if you're saying the pen, it's al-qalamu. Al-qalamu. Al-qalamu the pen, qalamun a pen. And teacher in Arabic, of course, is mudarrisun. Mudarrisun is teacher, and that mudarrisun means a teacher, and the teacher is al-mudarrisu. Al-mudarrisu. Now we want to make out of al-qalamu and al-mudarrisu, the pen and the teacher, we want to combine it to say the teacher's pen, or the pen of the teacher. The way we do it in Arabic is the pen of the teacher. So write the word qalam on the right hand side first up. Write the word qalam on the right hand side first up. The pen of the teacher. And then after the qalam, you write the next, after that you would write al-mudarris. So first you would write al-qalamu, then you would write al-mudarrisu. So you write the two words together, one after the other, al-qalamu, al-mudarrisu. And we trying to connect, as it stands, al-qalamu is the pen and al-mudarrisu is the teacher. There's no connection or linkage between the two, but we want to connect them up to say the pen of the teacher. The way we do it is, you form a unit with these two words, al-qalamu and al-mudarrisu. And the meaning of this is we want to make it the pen of the teacher. So what we do is the first of the two words, which is al-qalamu, the first of the two words, al-qalamu, firstly we remove the al from it. Firstly we remove the al from the first word, al-qalamu, so it becomes qalamu. It becomes qalamu. And secondly, normally when you have no al, you have tanween. You say al-qalamu normally becomes qalamun, qalamun, and it has a tanween. But here, in the first word, you remove the al from it, so it becomes qalamu. And secondly, you make sure it has no tanween on it. It has no tanween. So instead of qalamun, it will be qalamu. So the first word, al-qalamu, becomes qalamu. No al and no tanween. Now we come to the second word, which is al-mudarrisu. Remember, we want to connect al-qalamu and al-mudarrisu to make the meaning to be the pen of the teacher. So the first word we've removed al and tanween, or we've ensured that there's no tanween and we've removed al from it. So we call it qalamu, qalamu. And the second word, we come to that and we change the dhamma into a kasra. So the main thing in the second word is it should finish with a kasra. The second word finishes with a kasra. So al-mudarrisu becomes al-mudarrisi, al-mudarrisi. So the important thing in the second word in this unit of mudaf mudaf ilayh, the important thing in the second word is that it finishes with a kasra. Connecting the two together now, we have qalamu al-mudarrisi, qalamu al-mudarrisi, meaning the pen of the teacher. qalamu al-mudarrisi, the pen of the teacher. What we've done is the first word qalamu, we make sure it has no al, and we make sure it has no tanween. And the second word al-mudarrisi, we make sure that it ends with a kasra. Qalamu al-mudarrisi, meaning the pen of the teacher, or alternatively the teacher's pen. Qalamul mudarrisi, the pen of the teacher. More examples of that type would be kitabul mudarrisi, kitabu al-mudarrisi, meaning the book of the teacher. Notice again, kitabu has no al and it has no tanween. Al-mudarrisi has a kasra, kitabul mudarrisi. Likewise, daftarul mudarrisi, meaning the exercise book of the teacher. Also, baytu al-mudarrisi, baytul mudarrisi, meaning the house of the teacher. And notice again, baytu, it has no al and it has no tanwin. Al-mudarrisi has a kasra, baytul mudarrisi. Also, you can say baytu al-talibi, baytu al-talibi. Again, notice al-talibi, the second word has a kasra because it's joined to the first one. So baytu al-talibi, baytu is called al-mudaf, al-mudaf. And al-mudaf means an addition or the addition. Al-talibi is called al-mudafu ilayh, meaning added to it, added to it. Baytu al-talibi. Likewise, let's take another example. And here we notice a slight change in this example. Instead of baytu al-mudarrisi or baytu al-talibi, we say baytu Muhammadin, baytu Muhammadin. What's the difference here, baytu Muhammadin? The name Muhammad, it's a proper noun of a person. The name Muhammad, you never put al before the name Muhammad. You don't put al before name Muhammad as a normal thing. So since there's no al to Muhammad, it would have a tanween at the end. So it would be Muhammadin or Muhammadun, but it will not be Muhammadu or Muhammadi. Okay, you put a tanween because there is no al. And this is of course something we've done earlier, right in the beginning. So Muhammadun becomes Muhammadin because, as we said, the second word, you make sure it has a kasra. So baytu Muhammadin. So the second word has a kasra, but since it has no al, because Muhammad happens to have no al, therefore it is Muhammadin and not Muhammadi. But this rule is an old rule we've done from before, and it's not related to mudaf mudaf ilayh. The important thing in mudaf mudaf ilayh is the second word has a kasra, whether it's tanween or what, no tanween, that's irrelevant to this rule and it's not directly related to this rule. So we say baytu Muhammadin, baytu has no al and it is baytu and it has no tanween, so baytu Muhammadin, and the second word has kasra, baytu Muhammadin. More examples of this type, baytu Khalidin, baytu Khalidin, baytu Aliyin, baytu Aliyin, and baytu Hamidin, and so on. Instead of bayt, you can also make sentence such as, you can make phrase such as kitabu Muhammadin, kitabu Muhammadin, maktabu Muhammadin, maktabu Muhammadin, haqibatu Muhammadin, haqibatu Muhammadin, sayyaratu Muhammadin, meaning the car of Muhammad. Sayyara meaning car of Muhammad. And more words such as this can also be added together, and you could say qalamu Muhammadin, qalamu Hamidin, qalamu al-talibi, qalamu al-mudarrisi, and so on. The important thing of course is the first word has no al and no tanween, and the second word has a kasra. And together these two words are added like this and connected like this in this fashion to make a unit called mudaf and mudaf ilayh. And this unit gives you the meaning of the pen of the teacher, or something of someone else, belonging to someone else. This is the very first of the rules we learn in Ad-Dars al-Khamis, and this rule is very important because it is used so commonly in the Arabic language. So the way this may be used in a sentence is to make a sentence by saying هذا هذا. Before we learn to say هذا قلم هذا قلم, now with مضاف and مضاف إليه قلم المدرس قلم المدرس, we now make a sentence instead of هذا قلم, which is a proper and correct sentence. We make a more longer and more informative sentence and we say هذا قلم المدرس هذا قلم المدرس, or you could say هذا قلم الطالب هذا قلم الطالب هذا بيت المدرس هذا بيت المدرس هذا قلم الطالب. Likewise we did ذلك before, and ذلك means that, هذا means this and ذلك means that. So ذلك بيت المدرس, that is the house of the teacher. So you might point to something that's nearby, near you, a house that is right next to you, and also point to a house that is far away from you, and you would say هذا بيت الطالب هذا بيت الطالب وذلك بيت المدرس هذا بيت الطالب وذلك بيت المدرس, meaning this is the teacher, this is the house of the student, and that over there, that is the house of the teacher. You can put this in a question as well, and remember to make a question out of a sentence in Arabic, you can simply just add a hamza, a alif or hamza, a, in the beginning of the sentence. So we did earlier هذا قلم, هذا قلم is a jumla, it is a sentence. هذا قلم is a jumla, a sentence. To make it into a question or a su'al, question is su'al, to make هذا قلم into a su'al, we just simply added a hamza on alif in the beginning of the sentence. So we said أهذا قلم, أهذا قلم, meaning is this a qalam, is this a pen? And the jawab of course was نعم هذا قلم, نعم هذا قلم, or alternatively we had said لا هذا كتاب, no this is a book. Now we add a in beginning of a sentence with مضاف and مضاف إليه to turn that into a سؤال or a question. So our sentence that we had هذا بيت المدرس هذا بيت المدرس, you would add in the beginning a to make it into a سؤال, into a question, and you would say أهذا بيت المدرس أهذا بيت المدرس, is this the house of the teacher, أهذا بيت المدرس, and the جواب will be نعم هذا بيت المدرس نعم هذا بيت المدرس, yes this is the house of the teacher. Alternatively your answer may be in the negative and you'd say لا لا هذا بيت الطالب, no this is the house of the student. So the way to ask question is أهذا بيت الطالب أهذا قلم الطالب أهذا قلم المدرس أهذا قلم محمد أهذا قلم حامد, and so on. Now the way you see in the book in Ad-Dars al-Khamis is they put the هذا right at the end. They put the هذا right at the end, and that is perfectly fine. It's just the same, exactly the same meaning, just a different way of expressing it. There's no difference, you know, grammatically. There's no difference in terms of the meaning. Instead of saying أهذا بيت المدرس, you would say أبيت المدرس هذا. أبيت المدرس هذا. It's same as saying أهذا بيت المدرس. أبيت المدرس هذا. أقلم المدرس هذا. أبيت الطالب هذا. And so on. Or you would say أبيت محمد هذا. Meaning, is this the house of Muhammad? And so on. So it's exactly the same thing, just a different way of saying it by putting هذا at the end of the sentence instead of putting it in the beginning after a. That is the very first rule. That is the very first rule of Ad-Dars al-Khamis. The second rule of الدرس الخامس, the first one of course was the most important one, and it's called المضافو and المضافو إليه. Let's now go to the second rule of الدرس الخامس, and this is simply a new word. This is simply a new word, which is هناك. هناك. You write it with ها نون ألف ك. هناك. هناك simply means over there, pointing to something far away. Over there. And the opposite of هناك is هنا, meaning here. هنا meaning here, close to you or nearby you. هنا is written ها نون ألف. هنا. So in a sentence, you would say أين الكتاب؟ أين الكتاب؟ And the جواب would be هو على المكتب. It is on the desk. أين الكتاب؟ هو على المكتب هناك. هناك, pointing far away to you, to a desk that is far away. هو على المكتب هناك. Another example would be, you might ask someone, أين القلم وأين الكتاب؟ أين القلم وأين الكتاب؟ Where is the pen and where is the book? أين القلم وأين الكتاب؟ Now the قلم is right next to you and الكتاب is far away هناك. So your answer would be القلم هنا, القلم على الكرسي هنا, القلم على الكرسي هنا, والكتاب على المكتب هناك, والكتاب على المكتب هناك. That is the second rule. The third of the rules, the third of the rules coming in at Dars al-Khamis is again going back to Mudaf and Mudaf ilayh and to the sentence we did earlier, but this time just point using a masculine word in Mudaf or a feminine word in Mudaf and then pointing to it with the correct one out of hadha or hadhihi. Hadha of course means this for a male, and hadhihi is this for a female. And recall that in the Arabic language, any word that ends with a ta marbuta, the circular ta at the end, is regarded as a feminine word. And the example of that is haqibatun. Haqibatun means a bag. And because it ends with a ta, the circular ta at the end, it is a feminine word. As opposed to that, qalamun has no ta marbuta at the end, so it's regarded as a masculine word. Another example of a feminine word is sa'atun. Sa'atun means a clock or a watch. Another example of a feminine word ending with ta marbuta at the end is sayyaratun, meaning a car. Sayyaratun, a car. You write sayyaratun, of course, as seen, ya with a shadda on it, alif, and then a ra and ta marbuta, or the circular ta. Now let's look at this rule, or it's not so much a rule as much as alerting us to something. We learnt earlier that we say هذا قلم المدرس. هذا قلم المدرس. So picture in front of you is a pen, and that pen belongs to the teacher. The teacher may not even be in the classroom. The teacher may well be somewhere else. You can't even see the teacher. But you can see the qalam, the pen of the teacher right in front of you. So you point to this pen with your finger in front of you and you say hadha, meaning this. And you point to the pen of the teacher in front of you and you're pointing to the pen, you say hadha qalamul mudarrisi. Hadha qalamul mudarrisi. What are you pointing to? You're pointing to the pen, not the teacher. The teacher's not even in the room, but you're pointing to the pen. So that's why you say hadha qalamul mudarrisi. Qalam of course is mudhakkar. Mudhakkar meaning masculine. Qalam is mudhakkar, and hadha, this is for mudhakkar. So you say hadha qalamul mudarrisi. Now right next to the qalam is a haqibatun. It's a bag. And this bag also belongs to the teacher, but mind you, the teacher is not in the classroom. What are you pointing to? You're pointing to the bag in front of you, and the bag of course is feminine. And when you're pointing to a feminine mu'annath, feminine is mu'annath in Arabic, when you're pointing to something that is mu'annath or feminine, you don't say hadha, but you say hadhihi, and that's something we learnt in lesson number 2. So you say hadhihi haqibatun. meaning this is a bag. هَذِهِ حَقِيبَةٌ. Whereas for a pen you say هَذَا قَلَمٌ. So earlier we had said هَذَا قَلَمُ الْمُدَرِّسِ, pointing to the qalam. Now, pointing to the حَقِيبَةٌ, حَقِيبَةٌ, we say هَذِهِ حَقِيبَةُ الْمُدَرِّسِ. هَذِهِ حَقِيبَةُ الْمُدَرِّسِ. Why do we use the mu'annath feminine hadhihi? Because we're pointing to the haqibatun, which is a feminine or mu'annath. As for haqibatul mudarrisi, meaning al-mudarris, mudarris is not feminine, mudarris is masculine, but you are not pointing to mudarris, you're not talking about mudarris, and mudarris is not even in the classroom. So you say hadhihi haqibatul mudarrisi, because you're speaking about the haqiba, you're pointing to the haqiba. هذه حقيبة المدرس. So this is the point to learn in درس الخامس, which is to differentiate between what you're pointing to, which is قلم or حقيبة. So appropriately you use هذا or هذه, but that is irrespective of who it belongs to, the مضاف إليه, which is المدرس. So we say هذا قلم المدرس وهذه حقيبة المدرس. Likewise, you would say هذا كتاب الطالب, هذا كتاب الطالب, وهذه ساعة الطالب, وهذه ساعة الطالب. We said هذه because ساعة is feminine. As for طالب, it is مذكر, it is masculine, but we're not pointing to that. So with a هذا كتاب الطالب وهذه ساعة الطالب. Likewise, standing outside on the road, you have a car in front of you and you have a house right next to you. So you say هذا بيت محمد, هذا بيت محمد, وهذه سيارة محمد, هذا بيت محمد, وهذه سيارة محمد. Because سيارة is مؤنث feminine, because it ends with a circular تا, تا مربوطة. So that's why we say هذه. The fact that محمد in سيارة محمد, محمد is masculine, but that's not what you're pointing to. You're actually pointing to the car. محمد may not even be there on the whole road at all. So you say هذه سيارة محمد, هذا بيت محمد وهذه سيارة محمد. That is the third of the rules in الدرس الخامس. The fourth of the rules in الدرس الخامس is another new word that we introduce, and that word is تحت. تحت means underneath. تحت means underneath. So I ask you, I say أين, أين حقيبة المدرس؟ أين حقيبة المدرس؟ أين حقيبة المدرس؟ Meaning where is the bag of the teacher? So you want to reply by saying that the bag of the teacher, or it of course is here. حقيبة is مؤنث, so we say here. We're replying about حقيبة, not about مدرس. أين حقيبة المدرس؟ You want to say here, underneath the desk. The desk of course is al-maktab. So you want to say here, underneath al-maktab. The word for underneath in Arabic is tahta, tahta. And tahta means underneath. And you say here, tahta al-maktabi. Here, tahta al-maktabi. And tahta is regarded as a mudaf. And al-maktabi consequently, after the mudaf, finishes with a kasra. So you say here, tahta al-maktabi. Notice تحت finishes with a فتحة, with a تحت, and you don't say تحت, because تحت is one of those words that describes the position of an object, meaning underneath. Another example of a word that describes the position of an object with respect to another object is above. Underneath is تحت, above is فوق. فوق means something that is above something else, suspended up in the air or high up. So you say, for example, the word for above is فوق, and it acts like a مضاف. An example of that is, you say Al-qamaru, al-qamaru, al-qamar of course is the moon. Al-qamaru fawqa al-bayti. Al-qamaru fawqa al-bayti. Meaning the moon is above the house. Notice it's not sitting on the house, it's high above the house. Al-qamaru fawqa al-bayti. And likewise you would also say ash-shamsu, ash-shams meaning the sun. Ash-shamsu fawqa al-qamari. Ash-shamsu fawqa al-qamari, meaning the sun is above the house. And also ash-shamsu fawqa al-bayti. The sun is above the house. Ash-shamsu fawqa al-bayti. You can also say ash-shamsu fawqa as-sayyarati. Ash-shamsu fawqa as-sayyarati. So words such as fawqa and tahta that describe the position of one object with respect to another, these words are called dharf. Dharf meaning dha, ra, fa. Dharfun. And dha is the one that comes after ta, ta, dha. So you say dharfun. And dharf in Arabic, as I had mentioned earlier, it does not take a dhamma as a normal thing. Normally it has fatha and it acts as a mudaf. So you would say ayna haqibatul mudarrisi, hiya tahta al-maktabi. It is under the desk. Hiya tahta al-maktabi. Ayna al-qamaru, huwa fawqa al-bayti. Huwa fawqa al-bayti. It is above the house. So tahta, the dharf, is the fourth of the things we learn in Ad-Dars al-Khamis. The fifth of the things we learn in Dars al-Khamis is a tiny little rule, and this has to do with a nida or calling. In English, you say, O Muhammad. O Muhammad. When you're calling out to Muhammad, you say, O Muhammad. In Arabic, you call out to someone by adding Ya before their name. Ya before their name. So, Muhammadun. Muhammadun is a person, and you call out to Muhammadun by saying, instead of O Muhammad that you say in English, in Arabic, you, instead of Muhammadun, you say Ya Muhammadu. Ya Muhammadu. Notice what we've done here. When we added a Ya before Muhammadun, we removed the tanween of Muhammadun. So Muhammadun became Ya Muhammadu. Ya Muhammadu. And Muhammadu, of course, has only one dhamma and no two dhamma, no tanween. So you say, Ya Muhammadu. Likewise, Hamidun, Hamidun, we say, Ya Hamidu, Ya Hamidu. Khalidun, we call him by saying, Ya Khalidu, Ya Khalidu, and so on. So this Ya is called Harfu An-Nida, Harfu An-Nida. And nida means a call. Harfun nida means the letter of calling. So ya is called harfun nida. And when harfun nida comes upon a ism or a noun, the tanween drops and you just have one dhamma there. So Muhammadun becomes ya Muhammadu. And that is the rule number 5 in Ad-Dars al-Khamis. We have two more rules remaining. The sixth of the rule in Dars al-Khamis is right at the end of this lesson in exercise 9. They point out to two words, and these two words are ism, ismun. Ismun means a name, and another word is ibnun, ibnun, and ibnun means a son, son as in the son of a father or a mother. Now notice both of these words, the way they're written, you will notice it in exercise 9 at the end of the fifth lesson of Dars al-Khamis. The way ismun is written, the first alphabet, the first letter is alif, and this alif is called hamzatul wasl. It's called hamzatul wasl. Notice it does not have the normal hamza on top, but it's called hamzatul wasl, and this alif, the special thing about this alif is, if it obviously would come in the beginning of a word such as ismun or ibnun, But if this word with Hamzatul Wasl in the beginning comes at the beginning of a sentence wherein there is no other word before it, then you pronounce the Hamzatul Wasl in the beginning with a E. With a E. So you would say Ismun and Ibnun. Ismun and Ibnun. Ismun and Ibnun. So now, in a sentence such as the one we find in exercise 9, the sentence says, Ismul Waladi Muhammadun. Ismul Waladi Muhammadun. And it says, Wa, and again it's got the word Ismu. Again it's got Wa Ismu. But notice this time, before Ismu, there is Wa. So before Ismu, there is another word Wa. So we no longer have the need to pronounce the Hamzatul Wasl. We no longer have the need to pronounce that Alif or Hamzatul Wasl. So even though it's written there, but we drop it in pronunciation, and instead of saying Wa Ismu, we say Wasmu. Wasmu. Instead of Wa Ismu, we say Wasmu. So the important thing here is the Hamzatul Wasl, which comes in the beginning of words such as Ismun, Ibnun, this Hamzatul Wasl, it drops off in pronunciation if there is a word before it, such that you can connect the word before it to the word which has Hamzatul Wasl in the beginning. So we say Ismul Waladi Muhammadun, Ismul Waladi Muhammadun, Wasmul Binti Zainabu, Wasmul Binti Zainabu. So instead of saying Wa Ismu, we have said Wasmu. And likewise, in Al-Bint, Al-Bint, we have dropped off the Alif in Al-Bint, and we say Wasmul Binti, Wasmul Binti Zainabu, Wasmul Binti Zainabu. And if you look at the second sentence, you see an example of the same thing. In the second sentence it says ismu al-mudarrisi hamidun masmu al-mudiri. Instead of saying ma ismu, you say masmu, because before ismu, ismu begins with hamzatul wasl e, but before that there's another word ma. So because there's another word before e of hamzatul wasl, you drop hamzatul wasl and you say masmu al-mudiri, masmu al-mudiri, ismu al-mudiri hamidun masmu al-mudiri. And you do the same thing with Ibn in the next examples that you see in exercise 9. And you say, Ibn Khalidin fil madrasati, Ibn Khalidin fil madrasati, Wabn Hamidin fil jami'ati, Wabn Hamidin fil jami'ati. So that Hamzatul Wasl in the beginning of Ibn has dropped off because we have wa before it. So we say, Ibn Khalidin fil madrasati, Wabn. You don't say wa ibnu, you say wa ibnu hamidin fil jami'ati. The next sentence, ibnu al-mudarrisi fil fasli, ayna ibnu al-mudiri. You don't say ayna ibnu, no. You say ayna ibnu al-mudiri, ayna ibnu al-mudiri. So this rule teaches us about Hamzatul Wasl, that if there is a word before it, it drops off, but if there's no word before it, it remains, and you pronounce it as e. Before a noun, such as ismun and ibnun. The very last rule, which is mentioned extremely briefly in just one of the exercises in a dars al-khamis, is an adjective. An adjective. In English, we use the adjective by saying the small boy, the small boy. The small boy, notice the adjective which is describing the boy, the small, comes before. It comes in the beginning. But in Arabic, the adjective comes after. You first mention the thing that you are describing, then you mention its description or the adjective. And the important thing in Arabic is the small boy, what is small in Arabic? The small in Arabic is as-sagheeru, as-sagheeru. And the boy in Arabic is al-waladu, al-waladu. So To say the small boy, we first mention the thing that you're describing, which is al-waladu. Then you mention its adjective or description, which is as-saghiru. So you say al-waladu as-saghiru. Al-waladu as-saghiru. The small boy in Arabic is al-waladu as-saghiru. You mention the al-mawsuf, the thing being described, al-mawsuf. Al-mawsuf is the thing being described. You mention that first, and then you mention it's al-wasfu. Al-wasf is its description, and you mention it afterwards. Here it is as-saghiru. So you say al-waladu as-saghiru. Okay, so what are the rules to do with al-wasf and al-mawsuf? The rules to do with description and adjectives in Arabic are the adjective or al-wasfu. Here it is as-saghiru. It must match the thing that it is describing in every way. So the thing being described, al-waladu, is mudhakkar. It is masculine. So therefore, as-saghiru, the adjective, will also be masculine. You will not say the mu'annath form, which is as-saghiratu, as-saghiratu. No, you wouldn't say as-saghiratu. Rather, you would keep it as masculine, as mudhakkar, and you would say al-waladu as-saghiru. Secondly, the thing being described, al-waladu, has al in the beginning. So because it has al, therefore its adjective will also have al. So al-waladu as-saghiru. And thirdly, because the thing being described has a dhamma, as opposed to a fatha or kasra, so its adjective will also have dhamma and not kasra or fatha. So al-waladu, it's not al-walada or al-waladi, it's al-waladu as-saghiru. So the adjective comes after the thing it is describing, al-waladu as-saghiru, and it matches the thing it is describing in al. So you say al-waladu as-saghiru, and it also matches it in the sign dhamma, fatha or kasra. So you say al-waladu as-saghiru, and it also matches in masculine or feminine. So you say al-waladu as-saghiru, and you do not say al-waladu as-saghiratu. No. Rather, instead you would say al-bintu. Al-bintu is feminine. Al-bintu as-saghiratu. Al-bintu as-saghiratu. So if you turn over the page in al-dars al-khamis, to exercise number 4. In exercise number 4, it says Iqra, and if you go down to number 12, if you go down to number 12, the very last words are Fi al-Madinati al-Munawwarati. Fi al-Madinati al-Munawwarati. That's in exercise 4, in Dars al-Khamis, in lesson number 5, exercise 4. In question number 12, you find the very last two words, al-Madinati al-Munawwarati. Al-Madinati al-Munawwarati. Notice al-Madinati is, al-Madinati means the city. Al-Madinati means the city, and it refers to the city of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which is in Saudi Arabia. Al-Madinati meaning the city or the city of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And al-Munawwarati is a description or an adjective for this city. Al-Munawwar, al-Munawwar in Arabic, Munawwarun. Munawwarun in Arabic means something that is enlightened or brightened. Something that is illuminated, enlightened or brightened, that is Munawwarun. So because this is the adjective Munawwarun, but it is describing a word that is feminine, al-Madinatu. So because al-Madinatu is feminine and has a ta at the end, therefore munawwarun, we convert it to a feminine and we call it munawwaratun, munawwaratun. So munawwarun becomes feminine munawwaratun because the thing it is describing, al-mawsuf, is al-Madinatu and it is feminine. Second, munawwaratun becomes al-munawwaratu, it becomes al, because why? The thing it is describing, the al-mawsuf, has al in it as well, because it is al-Madinatu, al-Madinatu, therefore munawwaratun becomes al-Munawwaratu. Third, al-Madina, it has a fi before. In our question, in question number 12, it says fi al-Madinati al-Munawwarati. So fi is a harf al-jar, and it makes the noun after it and with a kasra. So fi al-Madinati, So al-Madinati ends with a kasra, therefore its wasf or its adjective or description, which is enlightened or illuminated, which is munawwaratun, we made it into al-munawwaratu, and now it is al-Madinati, therefore we would say al-munawwarati, al-Madinati, al-munawwarati, fi al-Madinati, al-munawwarati, fi al-Madinati, al-munawwarati. So notice, al-munawwara, which is the adjective, it is the wasf, it follows the mawsuf, al-Madinah, in three things. It follows it in it being feminine, so al-Madinatu, al-munawwaratu. It follows it in having al-Madinatu, al-munawwaratu, and it also follows it in having kasra, so we say fi al-Madinati, al-munawwarati. So the important thing about adjectives in Arabic is the adjective comes after the noun that it is describing, al-Madinatu al-Munawwaratu, and it follows it in three things, which is having al-Madinatu al-Munawwaratu, having ta marbuta, meaning following it in the gender, masculine or feminine, al-Madinatu al-Munawwaratu, feminine, and it also follows it in the sign, so you say al-Madinatu al-Munawwaratu or fi al-Madinati al-Munawwarati. This is examples of adjectives in Arabic, and there are so many examples of these rules in the Quran. You would do well now to open up the Quran and look up examples of adjectives such as this in the Quran, and notice how the adjective will follow the wasf, the adjective will follow the mawsuf it is describing in these three things, and it will come after it. In fact, you would also do well to go and open up the Quran and to look for examples of mudaf and mudaf ilayh, because there will be so many of them. And notice in mudaf and mudaf ilayh that the first word has no al and no tanween, and the second word has a kasra. So these are the principles that we learn in Dars al-Khamis. Now after you listen to these and understand these principles, you would then be advised to go on to the next recording. And the next recording will be reading or recitation of a Dars al-Khamis from the textbook of Tadribat textbook, reading of the Dars al-Khamis along with the questions and their answers and some more example answers as well. So first, once you get a grasp of this, then you can move on to that after that.